Welcome to another favorite segment, Mailbag!
Mailbag! Yeah! Mailbag's fun, isn't it, Sagan?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Now, first up, this one looks a bit banged up, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Looks a bit damaged. What do you think happened to it?
I don't know. I'm sure the inside is okay.
All right. It should be okay. It's from openbeam.de. Deutsch. Hi to all my German viewers. It's from Germany, Sagan.
Yeah.
Germany is on the other side of the planet.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what planet are we on?
Earth.
Planet Earth. Yeah.
Look, Daddy, red marks.
Red marks. I don't know what they are. Should we open it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's see what's in it. Okay.
Let's have a look. Even it looks a bit damp.
A bit what? Damp?
Yeah, damp.
Damp? You think it got wet?
No, damp means something is...
Do you mean damaged?
Yeah.
Yeah. Looks a bit damaged, doesn't it?
Yeah, a bit damaged.
Yeah. Let's have a look.
Yeah.
Let's cut across here. We've got a safety knife, haven't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, safety knife is really safe.
Yeah.
Well, it's still dangerous. You've got to take care. Yeah? All right. Now, oh look, it's just more paper.
Yeah, come on, let's get rid of it and see what's inside.
All right, he's keen. You see anything yet? Oh, hang on.
Something's in here.
There's something in there, you can feel it. Take it out and see.
Whoa, what is that?
I don't know. What is that?
Don't know.
It looks like some I-beams. No, they're maker beams, as the name says. You can build things with them. Yeah? It looks like an antenna, though. Looks like an antenna.
Yeah.
You could probably use it as... No, you can't. Well, maybe. But, yeah, what else is in there?
Very hard at the bottom.
Is there?
Yeah.
All right. What do we got? Let's have a look.
Yeah. Oh, here's
Make a Beam for Mailbag Monday.
Here's another.
Doesn't say who it's from.
Here's something else.
Wow. It's got a PCB attached to it.
What is it then?
I don't know. It's a bit. Well, you can make anything you want with them. See how there's got nuts and bolts on there?
Yeah.
And you can move those and make different shapes and things.
Okay.
You can make different things. No, I have to get a screwdriver to do it.
Oh, what?
Okay, Sagan, this one is from Tony. Tony Mukul, can you say hi, Tony?
Hi, Tony. It could be another parcel.
Another parcel? Well, these are, yes, maker beams. They're basically T-slot... A bunch of T-slot beams, and yeah, you can make all sorts of...
Look!
Wow! It's a Maker Beam clear starter kit with, ta-da, some postcards. Excellent.
And then...
Oh, look, Sagan, it's a dragon. Fire-breathing dragon.
Wow. And there's
Very
a box.
Very cool. And there is a box. Ta-da! So, take this out. And it did make it here, even though the package was really banged up. But look, we have a Maker Beam clear starter kit in a box, it says. Ta-da! Looks like, oh look, we even get the screwdrivers. Look, they're Torx screwdrivers.
And
a nut driver.
Wow.
Wow.
And
yeah?
And do you have to put it all together?
Well, we can make, yeah, it's a kit. So we have to assemble stuff. We can make anything we like. So it's got all these little L brackets, all different shaped angle brackets as well, and all the nuts, bolts, and all that for all these. And we can make any shape. Look, they've got some examples here, Sagan. Look, see, that's an Arduino, okay, and there's a PCB up there, and you can mount your boards on there.
Wow.
You can mount your circuit boards.
Dad, I want to make something with it right now.
You want to make something with it right now?
Yeah.
Look, we can make a spool holder, a wire spool holder. Check it out. That's an interesting idea.
Daddy,
there you go.
I want to hold this screwdriver in here.
You want? Thank you very much, Tony. Awesome.
Anything with any of these things.
Yep, we can make anything we like with all these T-beams. We can take them apart, we can reassemble them, and we can do anything.
Yeah.
It's terrific, isn't it? Are those screwdrivers going in your toolbox? Yeah? Are you going to put those in your toolbox?
Yep.
Excellent. And how old are you now, Sagan?
Four.
And where did you go today? Where did you go today? It was your first time.
Kindergarten,
big school, didn't you? Yeah, it was just orientation, but he's ready for big school, aren't you, dude? Because you're clever.
Daddy, can I make something right now?
You can make something right now. There you go. And yeah, and like that, and then turn it. See, and then you can loosen it and move it along like that. So you can move it anywhere you like, and then just tighten it up and boom. Oh, hang on.
But you always get stuck.
So there you go. You can get all these different pieces, can't we, Sagan?
Yeah.
Have we got them all here? I don't think we've got them all. I don't think we have 300. Oh, we might have 300 millimeter long pieces. Yeah? Is that about 300 millimeters?
Yeah.
That looks about 300 millimeters, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Total length? Yeah.
And it can even stand up.
It can even. Oh, actually, this is already made as the wire spool holder. So we can get our spools of wire and put them on here and just pull them off. All right, Sagan, you want to put the spool of wire on?
Yeah.
And then what do?
We can just use it for anything we want.
That's right. We can spool it off like that, yeah?
Yeah.
And then we chop it with our side cutters, yeah? And there you go. We can have real spools of wire on here. Beauty! Thanks, Tony.
And you can even wrap it up too.
You can wrap it back up. So how many spools do you think we can fit on here?
I think we can fit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
And that one.
And
six. Yeah.
I think we can
six spools of wire. Beauty! So Tony sent in the maker beam here, and basically it's that 10mm mini T-slot aluminium rails. Great for, you know, proof of concept type stuff like this, or pretty much anything. You're basically limited by your imagination. So they've got a whole bunch of, for those who want to read all the details, they've got brackets for NEMA 17 stepper motors, corner cubes, all sorts of stuff. So you can make pretty much anything with all this sort of stuff. So each of Fanny's legs, what are Fanny legs? Fanny, aka Project, okay, Fanny. There you go, Guinness World Record, search for Fanny the fire-breathing dragon, beautiful. More examples of what you can do with the I-beam. There you go. You can build all sorts of little robot-y type stuff. We've got more things. Check it out. And we've got a brochure. Oh, imagine having a lab just stocked full of these puppies. Oh, yeah. So these are all the pieces that you get in the MakerBeam starter kit. And, yep, they're all in there. Fantastic. Oh, look. Beautiful. Oh, beams. So thanks, Tony. They'll come in very handy, no doubt. And I'll link these in down below if you want to check them out. The company's called, well, the product is MakerBeam. The company's called chartup.com. All right, Sagan, we've got another one, haven't we?
Yeah. Wait, what's inside this one?
What's inside this one? I don't know. Let's find out. This is the one we didn't open last week. This is from Samuel Ferrero Marquez Lorenco again. And yeah, sorry, it sat here for a while. Where's our safety cutters? There they are. All right, you ready?
Yeah, ready.
All right, let's open it up. What do you think it's going to be?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I think it's going to be, I don't know. We never know what's inside any of your mailbag.
No, we don't, do we? It's a surprise, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a surprise. Sometimes I know things are inside.
You ready? Let's have a look.
Yeah.
There's a note.
Something. What's... and some lemons.
What do you think's in there?
One of this.
That's a PCB, isn't it?
And one of this.
It's a sticker. It's an Osh Park sticker. And, let's have a look.
And some of these. Some of these, Daddy.
More boards. Ta-da! This, I believe, is, it's an oscillator. It's an oscillator, say again.
Yeah.
Say 10 megahertz. Well, I believe it's 10 megahertz. We'll find out. And there we go. We got ourselves, I believe, it's a reference oscillator board. Cool. Let's check it out. You want to power it up, Sagan?
Yeah.
Where are you going to put the sticker?
Oh, I'm going to put this on me.
Oh, you got it upside down. Got it upside down. There we go.
Don't cover his dinosaur.
Cover the dinosaur. There you go. You got an Osh Park sticker. Thumbs up. All right.
Daddy, what are these?
They're little circuit boards for little connectors. You see all the holes in there?
Yeah.
See? They've got little small coax connectors, yeah?
Yeah.
And you solder them on there. That'll be fun, won't it?
Yeah. Dad, I want to power this up.
You want to power it up? Yeah?
Yeah.
Has it got an LED on it? It's got a light?
Yep,
there it is, right there.
Yeah.
Yeah? Let's go power it up.
We need some wire first.
We need some wire?
Yeah.
Yeah? Well, we can get wire from our wire spool, can't we?
Yeah, just there.
Yeah. Putting more stickers on you.
Yeah, I'm making it beautiful.
We've got clock generator stickers. I was going to say, the first thing I noticed about this is the DC jack on it hasn't got silk screened what the voltage input is. And, well, that's a big no-no because, you know, something like this you might, you're whacking your bins for when you need it and then you take it out and, you don't have the documentation with it. So instead of looking it up, you need it on the silk screen. But he supplied stickers. So we can stick it on the back, can't we? Yeah? So I'll put a sticker on the back.
Yeah.
And does it kind of sort of fit? Yeah, it kind of sort of fits. There we go.
In a rectangle.
Yeah. All right, now there we go. That's a bit shoddy work on Daddy's part. You're much better at stickers. Yeah? So now we can plug in a plug pack and light it up, yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
Daddy, yeah. We can get some wire over there.
We can get some wire from the wire spool. And let's read the specs, Sagan, shall we?
Yeah.
10 megahertz plus minus 0.28 ppm. Parts per million. Is that really good?
Yeah.
It's pretty good spec, isn't it? Yeah. It's not an ovenized oscillator, though. It's not an oven oscillator, but it's got a pretty schmick reference on it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But not over here, and the plug's over here.
That's right. Yeah. And where's the output from it? If this is the power and this is the LED, where's the output from it?
Here.
That's right, isn't it?
What do these do?
They output our 10 megahertz reference signal.
Yeah, do they power us up too?
No, power comes through here and then this generates a little signal on the board and it comes out on the connectors.
Right.
Yeah? And we can see it on the oscilloscope, can't we?
Yeah.
You know how to use an oscilloscope, don't you?
Yeah. Bye bye everyone! Bye!
And what Samuel sent in here is a little clock generator board. Uses a TCXO, a temperature compensated crystal oscillator from Abracom. We'll show a close up of that in a second. It's got a buffer IC on the output, dual outputs here. Why they're SMB instead of B and C, I'm not sure. I'm not sure why you need two on there. Maybe he had a specific purpose. I'm not sure if he actually says that or not in the letter. Anyway, open source hardware, of course, and there's not much else to it. There's no mounting holes on this thing at all, which is a bit disappointing because you might want to mount something like this inside your frequency counter or something like that. So I don't know, you might be able to find a mounting point or two, just a very small thing. But anyway, let's take a look at the data sheet for this puppy. And the standard crystal which he fits is the AST3TQ series, 10 megahertz, but he's got the Dash 2. Comes in different grades, but my board, he says he accidentally ordered the wrong one and he got the Dash 1 because it's a significant difference. We're talking about, like on Mouser, for example, this is like a $80 chip, $70, $80 for one-off quantity or something like that for the high precision. And you can actually get these going down to 50 parts per billion, PPB. But the one I've got here is the Dash 1, which is the 100 PPB or 0.1 PPM parts per million. You can talk in PPM or PPB. I don't know. PPM, it's got a bit more street cred. And it's got fairly decent specs for TC-XO of this type. And here's the data sheet. I'll link it in down below for those who want to have a look at it. I won't bother to mention the phase jitter and everything else because I have no reason to believe that it's not going to meet its data sheet spec. Abracon, reputable manufacturer, so it should meet its spec unless potentially you might damage the thing with your reflow soldering, for example. This is, you know, a precision part like this. When you're talking about, you know, a $50 or $100 SMD oscillator, you've got to make sure you get your temperature profile right. You don't want the assembler to just go use any old profile, not caring about that sort of thing. So that's just a little tip there. If you're getting a board like this manufacturer that relies on a critical part, and it could potentially not be ruined. Well, it can be ruined because it might not meet the spec anymore. Who knows what it's going to do if you cycle at a higher temperature or for longer or whatever. You don't get the right thermal profile. Pretty much, you know, they're only going to guarantee the specs for the thermal profile they recommend. So, you know, you don't want them just whacking on any thermal profile willy-nilly. So you're going to want to talk to your manufacturer when you're assembling something like this. You know, you don't want to go do run of 1,000 boards and find, oops, they're all ruined and you didn't tell them. It's not necessarily the assembler's fault. So, you know, you really have to tell them to get the temperature profile right on critical parts like this. And the data sheet has some phase noise plots too for you phase noise plot aficionados. Oh, look at that. Lovely. And I'd love to be able to show you the proper waveform, but my SMB adapter is kind of missing in action at the moment. So I got no idea where that puppy is. But yeah, there you go. So we've got just a tad bit of ringing there due to our antenna earth lead. Oops. But yep, there we go. 5 volts peak to peak at 10 megahertz. Near enough. It's probably, I think, this oscillator, oh, bloody touchy-feely, this oscillator might be better than the one built into this Keysight 500 megahertz scope. I think it is. So thanks for sending that in, Samuel. I'll link it in down below for those who want to check it out. Next up, we've got one from Wellington in New Zealand. Hi to all my New Zealand viewers. This one comes from Alan. Ooh. Sorry, Mr. Lego DeLorean. Sagan's put Doc and Marty into the diecast one. This one comes from Alan Douglas. Thank you very much, Alan. He's from Wellington, so let's rip it open and have a squiz. Ta-da! It contains... Well, I won't spoil it. Not that it's much of a spoiler, really. Let's have a squiz. What is that? Made in the old dart? Oh, cute! Let's have a look. Is there anything else in here? I'll show you in a sec. This is awesome. This is awesome. Yep. Hang on. Nope. That might give you a clue. I'll show you on the bench. Oh, isn't this gorgeous? Look at this Thandar SC110A oscilloscope. Tiny little CRT, miniature CRT display. Single channel, of course. None of this dual channel rubbish. It's a tiny battery powered. Look at it. Isn't it gorgeous? Battery powered scope. I love it. Made in the old dart. Fantastic, and if we slide that across and pull that out, we can even got a trace rotation on the back. Everything, check it out, we can power it from a couple of 4C cell batteries. Oh, we've got to power this puppy up. I know you want to see inside, but I want to power it up. I want to see I want to see if it works. First of all, this puppy's in really good nick. Serial number 74,000. I wonder if they did actually make 74,000 of them. So anyway, 10 megahertz. Oh, whopping 10 megahertz bandwidth. That was pretty decent back in the day, let me tell you. That was like a, you know, an ordinary, a decent, half-decent bench scope. So, bloody ripper. All right, I've put some batteries in. Let's switch it on. Oh, yes! What a Bobby Dazzler! Wow! Look at that! That is gorgeous! X shift. Oh, there we go. Oh, beauty! There we go, look at that! It's like I bought one! Oh! Oh! It's just gorgeous! Oh, hey, hello! Oh, it's a bit how you doing? Yeah. But still, considering the, oh, that's not the best, is it? No, we've got a few issues there. But geez, still works. Oh, look at the little dot. Ooh! I'll tell you what, if I change the vertical input there, oh yeah, it's not exactly, oh, there we go. So that's, 10 millivolts per division, 20, 30, 50, 100. Yeah, it's not the greatest. Can we get a 1 kilohertz sine wave? Whoa, look at that. I'm adjusting the trigger level there. We got it. Beautiful. What a Bobby Dazzler. It's not very bright though. That screen has it got an intensity adjustment on the back? Yes, it does. Let's spin that around. Oh. Yeah, no, that's maximum. That's maximum. So it's the best we're going to get. Hey, notice the amplitude. Did the amplitude change there, or is that just me? I'm viewing this at an angle. Anyway. And that is a 10 megahertz sine wave. Wow. Look on the right-hand side, though. Look at that. There's some non-linearity in the horizontal there. What? Look, it's not the greatest thing. I don't know if that was its original performance or not. But yeah, the trigger is extremely touchy at 10 megahertz. I barely turn that trigger knob and it's gonski. But it can do it. And I'd probably get lynched if I didn't do a quick 2-minute teardown of this thing and left it. Here we go. It's actually upside down. So there you go. You can access the components from the bottom here. The top side, of course, you wouldn't get much at all. And it's all through-hole stuff. None of this surface mount rubbish. Look at these carbon trimmers here. These are like, you know, the cheapest, crappest, you know, quality carbon trimmer resistors possible. Look at this resistor network here. That's a bit how you're doing, but you know, they're all different values, so none of this same value resistor network rubbish. Oh, we got some shielding happening there. Look at that. So we've got a shielding plate on the back of that. That'd be your horizontal board. So we've got, that's our horizontal timing board. Actually, the vertical's on there too. It's combined horizontal because you've got your horizontal shaft going right back to your multi-way switch down in there. Same thing for your vertical. So they've actually combined it. That's kind of unusual. Wouldn't expect that. Little bit of shielding on the top of the switches there. What's that for? Ah, that's our AC-DC input coupling. Okay, no worries. And what else have we got? Why are the tops of our transistors painted? Are they a matched pair? Tested? Hand-selected? They look for all the world like our input FETs, so maybe they have actually matched those. We've got ourselves a date code there. There we go. Second week, 1982. So, yep, very early 80s. I'm amazed how bodged this thing actually is. I mean, check out, we've got our high voltage board on the back. Okay, and check out this. They've got some wire wrap wire just sort of soldered directly into the board there, going around and tapping off into that transformer there. Like, what the, like, a complete afterthought. Unbelievable. That is about as how you're doing as you can get. Wow. So yeah, very crude design. Alan actually sort of compares it to the early Sinclair products and things like that. Yes, it certainly does have a very Sinclair sort of, you know, hacked together kind of feel to it. So yeah. Oh, there you go. Fender. Alan doesn't say, I don't think he says what this thing cost back in the day, but yeah, I can remember seeing ads for this and thinking, whoa, look at that, you know, lusting after it. But yeah, not impressed with the design or construction quality of this thing, that's for sure. But considering it's, early 1980s and it was maybe built down to a price, I suspect, you know, like they haven't really, you know, it's not like they've spared no expense on this thing. So it's sort of, you know, a rush job to get to market. Oh, we've got to get this tiny little portable oscilloscope. It'll sell like hotcakes. And yeah, it seems a bit rushed, but you know, it probably did the job and it probably sold and I don't know, maybe performed well, good enough. Let's say that. And it turns out Alan actually won my a DSR 1102E in my eBay charity auction last year for the mud run. I raised $10,000 for that for cancer research. So it's good to see it went to a good home. And I do plan on doing that charity mud run event again. So if you've got any ideas what wacky stuff I can do in there, hopefully, because I've buggered my knee if you've been following me on Twitter. Yeah, I'm trying to get back my knee back into shape so I can do the Tough Mudder in 3 weeks' time, which is a 20-kilometre one, and, well, hopefully I don't bust it, and then I'm okay for the mud run after that. Yeah, fingers crossed. So I don't know the exact history of Thander. I guess I'd have to look it up, but I believe they became Thirlby Thander, because I'm more familiar with the Thirlby Thander, it's always a tongue twister, Thirlby Thander products, but they were eventually bought out, I believe, by AIM TTI, who may have been bought out, I don't know, like there's just so many mergers, I don't know if anyone's got the exact story of how or where Thander ended up, but I'm pretty sure they're actually now part of the AIM TTI group in some way, shape or form. I wonder if there's any Thander engineers still there. Someone must know. So thanks, Alan. That is an awesome mailbag item. People will love this one, I'm sure. And it's not quite as good as the old Tektronics I tore down, but this has its own unique charm. Beauty. Got one from the United States of America. Thank you very much, Cole Larson from Clara City. Clara? Clara? I don't know. Clara Clayton? By the way, I didn't really try. I knew it would go for too much, but anyway, Clara Clayton's dress from Back to the Future was up for auction, and it started at like $1,500, and I thought, geez, I could get that, and the wife was actually interested in it too. She probably would have let me get it, but yeah, it eventually went for like $8,000 US plus buyer's premium and all the rest. Anyway, thank you very much, Carl. So that was a bit disappointing. I submitted for your inspection and dissection is a mystery device that he bought at a police auction. I think it was a piece of surveillance gear. What on earth is that? What on earth is that? Wow. Huh? It's got two contacts on it, labelled L and C. I got no idea. Some sort of, my first thought was some sort of passive infrared sensor or something, but geez, I mean, you know, you stick this on the side of the wall, what it, like, what? So what on earth is this thing? Hi, I can see myself. What the? Like, imagine having this on a wall plate. What is it? It's some sort of sensor device, is it? Or is it some emitter? I don't know. It's got L and C on there. It says rosin. What on earth is rosin? And how do you take it apart? Wow. I did not expect that. Look, there's a highly polished mirror in there. It almost looks like it's like a... Oh, no, actually, no. Yes, it is a mirror. I was going to say, like, it's a copper finish or something, but it's not. That's just this copper sensor, emitter, whatever the hell this thing is. We've got a backup battery here. It's like, what the? What is this thing doing? And the chips are actually branded rosin. Look at that. And we're talking 1979. Late 1979. Unbelievable. Rosin 1 and Rosin 2 chips. And this one is just a MC 4011. There you go. NAND gate. Quad NAND gate. Wow. Oh, why do we have a resistor cut? Not sure why we have a resistor that's been cut there. Do we have like a little FET? Couple of trannies in there, but what on earth is this thing? I don't know. More investigation required. I've got no idea. I almost don't want to take it out because I feel like if somebody watching this video can get me the data on this thing or knows what it is, maybe we can power it up and experiment with it somehow. But, you know, like, there's two terminals. I mean, it's got two terminals on the thing. So maybe it is just a transmitter, or does it modulate back onto the trans? I no idea. And what is the battery doing? This is beyond mailbag, I think. So, I'd love to have, just out of curiosity, have a play around with this thing. Somebody out there's got to have data on this, surely. If you do, please leave it in the comments. Actually, I'm going to have one more guess at that. Maybe it's some sort of unusual PIR sensor, passive infrared sensor, perhaps. Why it's got the backup battery in there? Backing up what? I mean, what do these two chips do? I mean, they're custom chips. Yeah, maybe some sort of passive infrared, but, you know, where's the Fresnel lens? And, like, I don't know. And it's interesting to note that this, you know, this is like the back of it. So, you know, it emits or receives or both out through this front. It's designed to be a wall plate. So that's why we've got our domed surface inside there. Well, a very quick Google on the name Rosin gets Rosin Corporation, who makes security products. So that seems to fit some sort of, you know, security type sensor thing. Mm-bob. Thingamabob. Yep, apparently there was a John A. Rosin who's listed in a whole bunch of patents, presumably the founder of Rosin Corporation, and yeah, once it, like, security sensor type application. So my guess is some sort of, passive infrared detector, the curved mirror in there. I didn't see any, it wasn't faceted in there to, you know, to give the, you know, a similar beam forming effect to a Fresnel lens, or yes, that's how I pronounce it, Fresnel, complain, flame away. I think it's some sort of, early PIR sensor. When did PIR sensors first come out? I'm not sure, but something like that would be my guess, because nothing in there seems to be high power. It's not like it's, you know, some ultrasonic transmitter or, you know, something like that. Some sort of passive detector. Fire, movement, all that sort of jazz. That's my guess. If you've got a better one, leave it in the comments. Thanks, Carl. That's awesome. Another one from Yankee Land, as seen on Kickstarter. Woo! It comes from Aquick CNC. Doesn't have a name, so thank you, Aquick. That could be the person's name, Aquick. Aquick CNC. So let's have a squeeze at what they've sent. So it's most likely going to be sorry if that was fragile. Most likely going to be some sort of CNC related item, is it not? By the way, when I'm editing this, I do notice that when I do open these packages, the shotgun mic actually peaks. So sorry about that. Let's have a squiz. I recently came across a flyer for a... oh no! The old free multimeter trick. Ta-da! Oh, one hung low if there ever was one. And yes, it's from Harbour Freight, and yes, it was free when he purchased a $3 torch. Wow. Even Harbour Freight have to be losing on that one, surely. Maybe not. A torch and a multimeter for $3. I'm sure he had to pay postage for that. And AJ has sent in this. Ooh, I almost don't want to touch it. It's like... All right, it's a Centec 7-function digital meter. Get accurate readings for DC voltage, blah, blah, blah. Limited 90-day warranty. Geez, thank you very much. Spared no expense there, Harbour Freight. But hey, you get this thing for free. The model 9899, Centec brand. And we're talking current accuracy, 1.2%, 3%, yeah, typical. 0.5% on basic DC volts accuracy, plus minus one digit. Nice and tight there. You don't want loosey-goosey specs. No sorry, Bob. And remember to keep children away. Bugger that, I'm giving it to Sagan. No, that's... Yeah, I can't give my own child a... No, a free multi, no. And remember to dress properly when you use these things. It's rule number 8. And just be careful, you young, long-haired yobbos. You know, you don't want to have your long hair looking like a complete wally when you're using your Centec free multimeter from Harbour Freight. Remember, don't overreach. Footing is absolutely essential. Your balance, critical when using a multimeter. Stay alert. This puppy could blow up in your face at any instant. And hey, I'm all for this one. Don't turn it on. Take it apart and check for damaged parts first. Beautiful. Avoid working alone. I'm screwed. This building is completely empty. There's nobody here. It's like 10:30, 11 p.m. at night. I'm a goner. Just don't do drugs, okay? Just don't. Oh, here it is. Da-da-da! Will it work? I'm going to turn it on. Bloody transistor tester. Never trust a multimeter that's got a transistor tester. I'm telling you. It works! HV, high voltage. Oh, because we're on the range. Oh, look at that. Isn't that nice and convenient for us? 200 volts DC is not high voltage? 0.2%! The Harbour Freight fanboys must be cheering! Yay! I knew it! It's a winner! Oh, it's almost bang on. I did see 100 there. Hang on, 1000. I did. Really? I did. Come on. Whoa. Oh, sorry. Maybe if I turn it in that direction, the electrons will settle a bit better. There we go. If I turn it upside down, maybe the electrons will fall out. No, there we go. It's almost bang on. It is bang on. Harbour Freight winner. Jeez, look at the current. It's bang on. Wow, look at that. 10 milliamps. Bang on again. Oh, would you believe it? This thing is stunning. And at 100 mic too, thank you very much. Oh, not too shabby on resistance either. And don't use ordinary safety goggles, they've got to be ANSI approved. You got it? And check out inside. It's actually fairly neat and tidy. You can see how they've got the cost down to absolute bare minimum. I mean, there's basically no input protection, doesn't exist. They've got a crappy M205 arc glass fuse, but that's what you'd expect in something like this. A chip on board, that would be the cheapest multimeter chipset on the planet, no doubt. And they couldn't afford the packaging, so the blob, the chip on board, is cheaper. Zebra strip down there, just go into the LCD. Absolutely bare bones. I mean, there's bugger all in this thing. There's the current shunt. I'm surprised they even go to the trouble to put in a 10 amp shunt on something like this. And I didn't notice this at first glance, but this is truly horrendous. This look, they've got a separate board here for the import because they wanted to make the square board, okay? I'm surprised it even has a little notch cut out because otherwise it's just a square board. They can manufacture those for the absolute bare minimum if you V-groove them. But no, they've actually fully rounded this because they had to go around the standoff there, so you know it looks like it's not V-grooved, it's fully routed, okay. But yeah, a second board just joined by solder blob there. Oh goodness, at least you've got maybe some extra fuse in there perhaps. I'm surprised they've gone to the trouble to put in four screws here to hold down the board, because that's an extra assembly step, and even in China assembly costs money. Oh, there we go. And oh, dual wipe, look at that. But yeah, like, there is nothing on this thing. Of course, you're not going to have double-sided load. Don't be silly. You can actually see the size of the die in there. There we go. You can see the outline of the die under there. So that's the size of the die, and then they just wire bond out to pads on top of the board and then blob the thing on top. But you can clearly see the second board just soldered on there. That's hilarious. They got some extra tracing on the bottom with a couple of vias there going through the top to get some increased current handling. But, oh, geez. Once again, I'm surprised, like, the transistor socket. Why even bother adding that? That's just extra cost. Like, just why? So there you go. There's the famous Harbour Freight multimeter. Thank you very much, AJ, for sending that one in. And, well, you know, it's built down to a there's the power switch down in there. And well, it's built down to a price, and I'd love to know what the true manufacturing cost of this out of the factory is, because they basically give these away, or you can buy it for like $5 retail. I think I've even seen them here in some hardware stores in like Bunnings here in Australia for like $5 or $10 retail. And the retailer is going to be taking like half of that. So what are they churning these things out for? Or, you know, in Harbour Freight's case, maybe they're a loss leader, because they just give them away for free. But I wonder, you know, they probably place an order for like, you know, 50,000 of these things, or maybe even more. I don't know. How big's Harbour Freight? 100,000 maybe. And they just give these things away, and it comes with a peak power battery. Yeah, 0% mercury. So they claim. What other toxic chemicals are in a peak power battery? Cheaper than disposing of them. Just, yeah, whack those toxic chemicals straight into the batteries. Yeah, no worries, mate. She'll be right. But, you know, look, they've even got silk screening on there. They could have saved themselves, I don't know, half a cent, a couple of 1 cent on their board by going for no silk screen. But I'm just amazed at what they can sell this for. And, look, people are going to complain if I knock this thing, right? You do not use this thing on anything mains rated, okay? It's got no protection whatsoever. It's incredibly dangerous to use this on, anything except low voltage DC products. And, well, if you get one free, you know, toss it in your glove box or, you know, something like that. But but for the price, like, it's free. So, you know, hey, my first multimeter, granted it was an analog, but, you know, it's, you know, this thing has better functionality than that. Can't complain. So thank you very much, AJ. We finally get a look at the famous Harbour Freight multimeter, Centec. Is that the actual manufacturer, or is that, yeah, I don't know the history of the Centec brand. So thanks, AJ, for sending that in, and it cost more to post it than it did to buy it, because you got it for free when you bought a $3 torch. Oh, God. I want off this planet.
Hi to all my Turkish viewers. We don't often get one from Turkey. I believe we have had one before. This is from Corey. Thank you very much, Corey. It's spelt Corey, but I know it's Corey because I speak fluent Turkish, obviously. So thank you very much, Corey. Corey. I'm getting there. All right, let's have a look. What is it? Ta-da. We have something stuck onto an envelope. A very nicely built fake copy of an already cheap fitness tracker. So if it's a copy of a copy, just like those SJ Cam 4000, which is a rip-off of the GoPro, and then there's companies that rip off that one, and it's, yeah, fantastic. It's teeny. Oh, it even came apart. Oh. 2 minute teardown, already done. And Korai has sent in this little fitness tracker thing. I mean, oh my goodness, he's already had a go at it. We've got a 40 milliamp hour battery in there. We've got ourselves, as that accelerometer? Is it? No, that's, what is that? What is that down there? I would have, no, okay. And no surprises for finding something like the Texas Instruments CC2541. This is a wireless Bluetooth microcontroller, and it basically does absolutely everything. So we're going to have an accelerometer down there. Is that what that other little QFN package is, perhaps? But yeah, there's, you know, there ain't much else. We've got crystal there. There's nothing on the bottom side, really. Nope. Got ourselves some charging terminals, which come from the end points here. And yeah, well, it's built down to a cost, but not a bad fit to envelope design, though. It does the business. And the other chip is 2633955. I'm not sure about that puppy, but my guess would be accelerometer. So thank you very much, Korai. That's an interesting 2 minute teardown. And well, yeah, it might be a ripoff, but you know, it's kind of, sort of doing the business, I guess. Although, yeah, the case, I don't know. It's a bit crusty, but built down to a price. Yeah, what does this thing sell? Bugger all compared to a Fitbit.
Another China Post item. I got no idea. It just says tool. It definitely has been shipped to that crazy Aussie bloke, so it is a mailbag. Ta-da! Oh, again! Again! I've got another wrist strap. Why? Thank you. Okay, didn't I get one the other week? Yeah. This one doesn't, at least the other one had a funny packet, if I remember rightly. This one doesn't even have a funny packet. It's just got an anti-static wrist strap. You can never have too many. Thanks. Looks like we've got another random eBay one. I'm pretty sure it's not something I've ordered because it was sent to my locker, which I usually don't get stuff sent to. It's just my public address. So it looks like maybe somebody's bought something on eBay. It looks sort of like classic kind of eBay come through China Post. So let's have a squiz. There we go. Even the plastic bags are like cheap. It's not even new. It's been used like 10 times or something. Anyway, nothing wrong with that. What the hell is this? It's a remote control. And it's, no, what is it?
We got ourselves an alcohol tester, hence the 0.05 percent our blood alcohol limit. That's our legal limit here in Australia for an adult anyway. It's lower or nothing for red and green P-platers, I believe. Anyway, I've put some batteries in it and it doesn't work. I mean, it switches on. Okay, and it's supposed to wait like 30 seconds and it's supposed to warm up, you know, adjust itself to the, you know, what atmosphere it's in. And then it's supposed to do something, but I can't get it to work at all. So it's a complete and utter failure. I'm not sure what these things cost. Well, they cost a couple of, you know, cost more to post them than it does to actually make the thing, I suspect. 2 minute teardown. We've got our alcohol sensor. There's no brand on that. If somebody can identify, it's a Blue Dot brand. There we go. Yeah, whatever they could get in the Shenzhen market this week. But yeah, there's no micro or anything like that. It's just an LM324 quad op amp. That's it.
So I can only presume that the alcohol sensor actually outputs a voltage, and we've got a comparator with the op amp, and that's it, and lights up some LEDs. That's got to be all there is to it. So thanks to everyone who sent something in for today's mailbag. If you liked it, please give it a big thumbs up. And as always, discuss it on YouTube, on the blog, on the forum, all those sort of places, wherever. Follow me on Twitter. Yeah, subscribe if you haven't already, although I suspect if you've already gotten like 40 minutes into this thing, you've probably already subscribed. Catch you next time.